Good morning, church. We'll try that one more time. Good morning, church. There it is. What a great day it is to be in the house of the Lord. Amen? Amen. So good to see each and every one of you here with us this morning. We are so glad you're here. If you are a guest with us, we just also want to say welcome and thank you for coming to visit us this day. In the bulletin, we do have our connection card. It looks just like this. And again, if you're a guest visiting with us today, we would really appreciate it if you'd fill this out so we can just follow up with you and get to know you. And we can reach out and tell you thank you for joining us this day and get you some more information. So let us know through that connection card. Also, if you have any prayer needs, at the very bottom of the connection card, there's a spot right here. We would love to be praying for you. If you have a praise to share, write that right there on the connection card. You can drop it in the offering plate as it goes by, okay? A few things to highlight this morning in the bulletin as a way of announcements. First, we do have a Sunday school teacher and director training meeting. That is today at 4:30 p.m. in the craft room. I know not everyone knows where the craft room is. If you head in the Family Life Center, our blue building, down the hall past the bathrooms, it's the last door on the left is our craft room, and that will be at 4:30 p.m. today. We have lots of openings for our adult, youth, and children's departments. And so if you feel led or maybe just want some more information, you can come to this meeting. Again, that's 4:30 p.m. today in the craft room. Second, our deacons meeting, it has been rescheduled for this next Sunday, February 25th at 7 p.m., okay? Please read over the bulletin as well. If you have any other questions about upcoming events or ministry opportunities, feel free to reach out to us. I know our office phone number is right here on the back of the bulletin, okay? Again, it's a joy to be here with you this morning. Let's go ahead and go to the Lord together in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for this morning, Lord. We thank you for the cool temperatures outside. We thank you for the sunshine that's now coming through, Lord. We just are so blessed by this day that you've given us. We thank you for the breath that you've breathed into our lungs, knowing, Lord, that each day is a gift from you. Lord, thank you for this time that we can be together as your church. Lord, I thank you for each of these who are here with me this morning. We pray for those who cannot be here. Lord, we know many are still struggling just with health issues. Some are in the nursing home right down the street here, Lord. And we just pray for your healing power upon them, that soon they would be back in our number. Lord, we thank you for this time now that we have to come to worship you through song and praise and through the studying of your holy word. Lord, please be with the praise team as they lead us in song. Lord, be with Pastor Greg as he brings your word to us. Lord, may you challenge and encourage and change us to be more like you, Father. Lord, help us in all we do, in word and deed, to honor and to glorify your name. We love you, Lord Jesus, and we just ask these things in your precious name. Amen. We're going to have our fellowship song, so as the song goes, let's make sure to go and greet those around us.
To sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of His grace. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of Thy name. Jesus, the name that calms our fears, that bids our sorrows cease. 'Tis music in the sinner's ears, 'tis life and health and peace. He breaks the power of canceled sin, He sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean. His blood avails for me.
Ladies and gentlemen, I invite you to take your seats as we observe the ordinance of baptism. OK.
Can y'all hear me? Am I on? There we go. All right. Good morning. Good morning. We're gonna try this till we get a response. Yeah. All right. Well, we are gonna baptize, but I'm out here by myself because this water is freezing. And I told Braxton I would do the introductions before he comes down so he doesn't have to stand. He chose to stand. He's excited about his baptism. And he wanted to be baptized today and not put it off, and I'm glad for him. But it is cold, so y'all pray for Braxton that he doesn't get in and jump right back out. So, he said he was a little nervous. I said, once you hit that cold water, you'll stop being nervous. So, Braxton, he is right here beside me, and I'm going to bring him down in a second. Braxton has been in our children's department and those ministries since he was just a little fella. His teachers have done such a wonderful job just introducing him to Jesus. And about 3 weeks ago, he made his profession of faith, wanted Jesus in his heart, wanted to follow in obedience and be baptized. And so that's where we are today. And with that, I'm going to bring him in. We're going to see how he feels in this water. He's taking deep breaths. All right, let's stand on this block. All right. This is Braxton. Braxton, do you believe that God sent his son Jesus Christ to die on the cross for you, that he died, he was buried, and he rose on the third day?
Yes, sir.
And have you invited him into your heart as your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes, sir.
Amen. Amen. As a show of support for Braxton, I will ask his friends and family members to stand for just a moment. All right, you may be seated. Braxton, face this way. Hold my hands. Let's come forward. I think you'll be okay off the block. All right. Braxton Moore, upon your public profession of faith and your willingness to follow Christ in baptism, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit. Take a breath. Buried in sin and raised to walk a new life. Touch feet. All right, let's get you out of here. I think I heard, that's cold. thank you for being here. What a great way to start our service. It's so special. It may encourage some of us who have not followed in believer's baptism to follow that practice, of course, with heated water, right? Let's pray together. Let's pray. Lord, we are grateful for the day. Thank you for the opportunity to witness Braxton's baptism. We pray for him as a young brother in Christ that you would help him to grow more and more. May he love you more each day, and may he serve you with his life. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you will, if you'll stand with us again as we sing Lily of the Valley.
I have found a friend in Jesus, he's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him alone I see all I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my stay. He tells me every care on him to roll. He's the lily of the valley, the night and shining star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He all my griefs has taken, and all my sorrows borne. He lives patience, he's my stone and my guitar. I have all for him to forsaken, and all my idols torn from my heart, and now he keeps me by his power. Through all the world forsake me, and Satan tempts my soul. You, Jesus, I shall safely reach a goal. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here, while I live by faith and do his blessed will. Oh, wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With this manna he my hungry soul shall fill. Then sweeping up to glory, to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roar. He's a lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. While passing through this world of sin and others, your life shall view. Be clean and pure without, within. Let others see Jesus in you. Let others see Jesus in you. See Jesus in you. Keep telling the story. Be faithful and true. Let others see Jesus in you. Your life's a book before their eyes.
Today, so I've got assistance with our new brother in Christ.
Braxton. Are you ready? Shall we pray? Our Lord in heaven, we come to you and thank you for this blessed day to come here and worship you and to be with you. We pray, Lord, for the forgiveness of all of our sins and trespasses, known and unknown. Lord, we pray for this tithing to go towards your word and your works. And we pray this in your blessed name. Amen.
I'm going to ask my children, do you want them now or after Lord's Supper? Because I'm very well good with them sitting and watching so they can learn. Okay, very good. All right. We get to celebrate Lord's Supper Day, baptism and Lord's Supper. And what a great day just to be able to celebrate both of those things. The table, when we come to it, we're told by the Bible, we come to remember. What are we remembering? Jesus' obedience, his sacrifice, his great love for us. We will take... We have a little, those little containers, still using the little containers. They are gluten-free, in case you need that. We will wait and do this together. I'll walk you right through. We will peel open one portion of it, revealing the wafer, which is a little cracker. It is symbolic. It is a symbol of the body of Jesus given for us. After we do that, again, by direction, we'll do this together. We'll turn it back over. Peel the foil, and there will be a juice in there. It is symbolic of the blood of Christ poured out for us. And we'll read some scripture together and walk through that. Now, if you have asked Jesus to come into your heart as your Lord and Savior, and you know that without a shadow of a doubt, you are invited to participate. There are reasons not to take the Lord's Supper. I'm not going into it, but the scripture says this. Do not eat or drink judgment upon yourself. There may be some sin in your life that is unconfessed that would keep you from coming to the table. You may be at odds with a fellow person that would keep you from coming to the table. And I say that because I don't want you sitting there and feeling left out, because the table is always important. It points us to Jesus. And that's why I asked if we could leave these children here today so they could watch. And then they'll go home and ask their parents, why didn't I take, or why were you doing this? And so that's what we're going to do together today. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's pray together. Lord, as we just pause for a moment and reflect, we lift up to you our gratefulness. We think about the obedience that is spoken of in the second chapter of Philippians, that you were obedient to God the Father, even to your death, a horrible death. But Lord, you did it for us. You gave your body for us. And we give you thanks today for that, taking the punishment that we deserve, facing in shame, the shame that we deserved, you gave of yourself. And as we take this bread, this wafer in just a moment, may we remember your great sacrifice, and may we be inspired to love others as you have loved us. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Serve you. with the wafer pointed up. If you'll pull that tab, you should reveal it and have it in your hand. We'll eat it in just a second together. From John 6, we read these words, Jesus speaking, I tell you the truth, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. The body of Christ given for us. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. Roger Lowry, would you lead us in prayer? Giving thanks for the blood of Jesus shed for us.
Dear Jesus, it's through grace you are saved. It's not by works, Lord, but it wasn't free because you took the beating of a lifetime to spill the blood. Your body to cover our sins. You knew that we needed a Savior, so you came down from glory to hang on the cross.
Yes.
Lord, as we take this supper, I ask and pray that we remember these things, that while the gift of eternal life is free, it was not free the blood that was spilled. I thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. If you'll turn your cup back the other way. Peel that top. I'll read some scripture to you, and then we'll share together. Hebrews 9:22 says, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. And in 1 Peter 1, verses 18 and 19, we read, for you know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver and gold, that you are redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your forefathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect, the blood of Jesus given for us. Amen. Amen. If we have children now who would like to go to children's church, Miss Jeanette, Miss Emily are at the back. The rest of you, please open your Bibles with me to Ephesians chapter 1. We'll be looking today at verses 1 through 14. Ephesians 1, 1 through 14. When you find your spot, if you're able, stand and join me as we read those verses together. Ephesians I am reading from the ESV. What you will see up here is not ESV. If you would like to follow along with me, the black Bibles in the pew will have the same words that I have for you now. And I'll give you a second in case you need to turn to find them. Let's read together. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and are faithful in Christ Jesus, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, with which he has blessed us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we, who were the first to hope in Christ, might be to the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it, to the praise of his glory. And God's people said, amen. Let's pray. Lord, may you bless the reading of your word, the study of your word. May your spirit move in this place. May we find in what we study today some things that are reminders, some things that challenge us to go out and share our faith. And may we all be encouraged by your great love for us. We'll see it in this passage. We pray together in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated. It was almost 1 a.m. when the phone rang. Dr. Leo Winters, a highly acclaimed, renowned doctor in the Chicago area, was called because he was needed at the hospital. A terrible accident had taken place, and they wanted his hands there to perform a surgery to perhaps save a life. So he left his home, and he didn't have much time, so he took the shortest route that he could think of, and it led right through a tough area of town. As he was driving along, he came to a stoplight. He stopped there, and a man with a gray hat and a dirty flannel shirt ripped open his door, and he said, "I've got to have your car," and he threw the doctor out, and the doctor was left there with no car. And it took him a long time to get a cab willing to come into the neighborhood to take him to the hospital, and over an hour had passed when he finally got to the hospital. The surgical team met him, and they said, "Where have you been?" The patient lost his life about 30 minutes ago. And so the doctor asked, "Where was the family? Where was the family?" The nurse told him that the father of the victim had gone to the chapel, was there wondering where the doctor had been. And when the doctor walked into that chapel, he hurried to go there and just to explain what had happened. He entered, he saw the father who was wearing a gray hat and a dirty flannel shirt. And I picture this, and I think along the line with you, the one who might have brought life, the one who might have brought salvation, was rejected because a father thought his was the way, his way was the better way to act in this situation. And I think about that in our lives as well, because we are taught from a very young age, be independent, do things for yourself. You don't really know God. We are like the desperate father in that tragic story because we do try to do so many things for ourselves. Amen. That only God can do. Amen. Today I want you to see in the scripture several things that God the Father does, God the Son does, God the Spirit does. And we need to learn and allow ourselves to be directed by God in all things. And we begin by looking at the work of the Father. Verse 4, we're told right off, He chose us. Isn't that a great thing to know that God chose you? I can think back all the way to the time when I was in grade school. You're out on the playground and teams are being formed for the kickball game. And they say, okay, you're a captain, start picking. And ideally, you are picked very early in the process, because when you wait to the end, it's like, okay, you get stuck with Pastor Greg. And that's not what we want to feel like. You want to be chosen because it reminds you that you are important. You are important to God. He chose you. And in our scripture, and we need to think about this. By our nature, we don't choose well, do we? By our nature, we make a lot of bad choices. And that's why we needed God to choose us, to choose for us. Jesus says to his disciples in John 15, 16, you did not choose me, but I chose you. And Paul acknowledges really the wonder and the blessing of being chosen in verse 3, which we've read already, but he says there, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. So we're chosen by God, but we're told we're chosen for a purpose. Also, still in that verse, we'll read again, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be what? We should be holy. We should be blameless. God wants us on his team. He chose us for a purpose. And the first is this, that we are set apart. The Hebrew word is kadosh, and that's what it means, to be set apart. Be holy, set apart. Now, what it means for us is not to be out of the world, but to be different from the world. I had a young lady tell me this morning, she works in our prison system, and she is a teacher in the prison system. And one day in class, this week, a person came up to her and said, are you a Christian? And they kind of were keeping their distance. And the reason why, this person is a worshiper of Satan, and noticed the very presence of God upon this teacher. She was in the world, but she was different from the world. On Friday, y'all like my haircut, by the way? Listening? On Friday, I went and got a haircut. And one of our church ladies was in the it's not really a barbershop, Texas Hair Club, whatever that is, barbershop, hair salon. And I've been having the same lady cut my hair now for a few times. And we talk about church stuff. And she knew that this other lady was one of my members. And the lady came to me this morning and she said, as soon as she left, she came over and started asking more about the church. And I said, that's good. That's what we want, to be different, but also recognize. And sometimes it's so subtle what's going on, you don't notice it, but we are still to be what? The salt and the light of the world. So they do take notice and they want or recognize that there's something different, and they may want that for themselves. So God wants us to be holy. He wants us to be noticeably different. Some of you have probably read Herman Melville's Moby Dick. And in this gripping story, there's a scene where Captain Ahab tightens a vise on his hand. And it almost looks like that he is being self-punishing, masochistic. He screws the jaws tighter and tighter. And he's grimacing, and he looks to the sky. He looks to the sea, and he says it to himself. He says these words, a man has to feel something that holds in this slippery world. A man has to feel something that holds in this slippery world. I read that quote, and we need it too, don't we? We live in a slippery world. We need something to hold. Our society is permissive, to say the least. Our society seems bent on gratifying and catering to our wants, to our whims, to our desires, and never in the way of doing right. It's all in the way of pleasure. And that's where this society's gone. If it feels good, do it. It's not an adequate direction for our life, and yet that's the way society pushes us. We need something to hold on to, and it is that holiness. being more and more like God. So God calls us to esteem. He calls us to be holy, but he also calls us to be blameless. The words I've written beside that in my notes, above reproach. I don't know which one works better for you. The Greek word for blameless is amamos, A-M-O-M-O-S. And I tell you that not so you learn the Greek, but to know its meaning. It has a sacrificial meaning. It means, again, to be unblemished. Now think about that with me. Our lives are to be that sacrificial idea, an offering to God, an unblemished offering to God. Much like what Paul writes in Romans 12:1, I appeal to you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is what? It's your spiritual worship. We're called to do that. We're called to be holy. We're called to be blameless. Why? God chose us. Number two, God loves us. Also in verse 4, sometimes that's not an easy thing to do. I don't hear any amen, so that's good. Thank you, Robert. Sometimes it is not easy to love us because it's not even that we're unlovable. We go even a step further. We make ourselves unlovable. And we clean up pretty well, don't we? We clean up well. And yet in our homes, in the workplace, sometimes even in our neighborhoods, we don't present that way. We may present something that is very unlovable. There was a lady in a diet club, and she was lamenting that she had gained weight. And she told the group, I made my family's favorite cake this weekend. We ate half of it together. The next day, I was looking at that other half of the cake, and I took a very thin slice. But then I took another very thin slice. And soon the whole cake was gone. She said, I'm hating myself because I didn't have willpower not to eat the cake. And I'm upset. What is my husband going to think about me for not doing right here? They were commiserating with her group was. And finally someone asked, what did your husband say when he found out? She smiled. She said, he never found out. I made another cake and ate half of it. Aren't you glad that we don't have to play that type of game with God? We don't have to do that. At times, there is no one else to love us, but God does. He chose us. He loves us. Third, verse 5, he predestined us. Everything that God does is by his initiative. It is by his choice. And here we see grace abounding, in some translations word it this way, by the good pleasure of his will. Grace abounds to us. And these verses emphasize that God is sovereign over all things. And in essence, you could pull these verses to remind you, God says, this is the way that I have predestined you to be saved. And it is through Jesus Christ. Now, people read Ephesians chapter 1, and they will use it as their scripture basis for saying predestination is out there. You don't have a choice in whether you are saved or not. But I would say to them, they're taking Ephesians chapter 1 out of context from the rest of scripture. Now, there's an argument here. I'm not going to go that far against. I see what they're saying, but I will say there's so much more. And when we're making a theological point or making a decision based on scripture, we need to look at all of scripture, or much of scripture at least, not just one verse. That's called proof texting when we do that. And so we come to this verse, or these verses, this section, but I tell you, we need to be reminded of other points. And I think one of the most outstanding, most memorable verses would be John 3:16, where we read, for God so loved the world that he did what? He gave his one and only Son, and that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have what? Eternal life. Now, you can read about being predestined in Ephesians, but then when you come over to the third chapter of John, we are reminded, who did Jesus die for? He died, we're told he died for every person. And also we see these words, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. So whoever is a reminder, Christ died for all, do all receive that gift? If they choose to, they do, but it's not guaranteed because not everyone will make that choice. But have eternal life then reminds us that this life is given out not based on our works, but based on in a relationship with the Savior who gave His life and then was resurrected to life. It's important for us to see whatever God purposes is sure to be fulfilled. For God so loved the Son, whosoever believes in Him, in His death, in His resurrection, shall not perish but have everlasting life. God gave so that we may have life. So we see the work of God very briefly here. We see also the work of the Son. Verse 6, to the praise of His glorious grace with which He has blessed us. God has given us grace. Grace is not dependent upon others around us. Grace does not even fall to you based on performance. There are many religions that feel like I can't be right with God until I do certain steps. But that's not what the Bible teaches. I've shared this illustration before. Years ago, I was at a Thanksgiving luncheon with Jenna and Suzanne and some international students. And one of the students asked the question, what do you have to do in your faith to belong to Jesus or to belong to God? And we said, you receive what He offered. And he began to try to name off the performance steps in his religion, which he couldn't even do, which was a sad thing. But even the fact that he'd been taught, if you want to have a relationship with God, you got to do this, you got to do this, you got to do this. He hadn't done those things and couldn't even remember what he needed to do. And I will tell you today, if you want relationship with God, here's what you need to remember. Ask for forgiveness of sin. Ask for Jesus to come into your heart and then walk with Him. That's what you need to remember. Lily Baltrop was a good bus driver. This is many years ago. Her story was written in the Fort Worth Star-Telegram, 1988. And it said that Lily Baltrop had gone a whole year without an accident on her bus, and she was being given an award. Lots of other bus drivers who had done similarly well were in that group. She drove so well that they elected her to drive the bus to the award ceremony. Unfortunately, on the way to the ceremony, you know where this is going. Lily turned a corner too sharply. The bus rolled. And 16 people had to go to the hospital. How ironic. How ironic. And here's the question. Did Lily, who had been accident-free for a whole year, get her award anyway? Absolutely not. Because awards committees rarely operate on the principle of grace. But God does, and aren't you thankful? God operates on the principle of grace. How fortunate we are that even when we don't maintain a spotless life record. By the way, does anybody have one of those? A spotless life record? I don't think so. Even when we don't, our final reward depends on God's grace and not our performance. Amen? That's something to be thankful for. Jesus gives grace. Number two, He has redeemed us. Back in verse 7, in Him we have redemption through His blood. And that may seem like a strange phrase, but in the New Testament, it's not strange at all. It's something that Paul uses repeatedly. Colossians 1:20, for sinners, quote, Jesus made peace through the blood of His cross. Romans 5:9, we are justified by His blood. Ephesians 2:13, those who were once far off, quote, have been made near by the blood of Christ. We are brought near to Him by His blood. Because it's a blood that we, when we talk about it in Scripture, and we talk about it in our services, the blood is a cleansing blood. His blood covers over us. Scripture tells us, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. And you have to go back and begin to think about the Old Testament practices. When you sin, you had to bring an animal to the temple, what? To sacrifice. Blood was shed, and that's what they believe brought forgiveness. When we get to the New Testament, we're told that it didn't matter how many priests shed how much blood, because the only blood that truly mattered was the blood of Jesus Christ. He was the Lamb of God without blemish and without defect. But Paul speaks of that blood. Jesus overlooked our sinful state, and as He overlooked that, He gave Himself for us. So He gives grace. He has redeemed us. Verse 7 also, He has forgiven us. He looks beyond our trespasses. He sees us in a different light. Now, the word that is spoken of here and used here has its origin in the Old Testament, and it pictured the release of a slave or even the rescue of alienated land by payment of a ransom. And if you're interested, go back and read Leviticus 25. This whole section, 25 through 55, talks about that process. But we also see in the use of this word the metaphor that was used in referring to Israel's release from Egypt, Egyptian bondage, but also Israel's release from Babylonian captivity. They were deported there, they were taken. But it's that same idea. God rescued his people, and this is how he did it. Raceland Flood wrote a book, The Last Years. And in his book, he chronicles some of Robert E. Lee's life after the Civil War. And in one little section, he tells about Robert E. Lee going to visit a widow. She lived in Kentucky, and she was glad to see Robert E. Lee. She takes him out into the front yard, and she begins to moan over this tree in her yard that had been destroyed. It had once stood as a beautiful tree, destroyed by Union artillery fire. She said, look at these limbs. Look at the way that they destroyed this tree. And she wanted Robert E. Lee to join in her moaning and her griping and at least to sympathize with her. But this is what he said. He was silent for a moment, and he finally said, cut it down, my dear madam, and forget it. Cut it down and forget it. You see, it's better to forgive the injustices of the past and to let them remain, to let bitterness take root and then poison us from that day further. Jesus sets us free so that we're not trapped in sin. We're not trapped in hatred. We're not trapped in thinking about what someone else did wrong to us. That is part of the work of the Son. We finally look at the work of the Holy Spirit. Verse 13, in him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. He has sealed us in Jesus Christ, the He being the Holy Spirit. Now, what I want you to note from that verse is that believing is the link, and it's a vital link between hearing and being saved. So we hear, and salvation's over here, but what has to happen in between? We got to believe. You've got to receive it. That is the vital link. Being sealed then becomes a picture of ownership. There are lots of pictures in this passage today. It's a sign of ownership. In the day, and even in this day, cattle were marked. They were sealed. We say they're branded. In that, the day that we're reading of, there were slaves, and they were sealed by their owners, that they belonged to their owners. And my question is this, are we marked as slaves for Jesus Christ? Have you been sealed for that day? And I have for you some interesting scriptures. We'll go on right here, Ephesians 4:30. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. But then also in Revelation 9, verse 4, they were told not to harm the grass of the earth, or any plant or tree, but only those people, and here it's important to note this, who did not have the seal of God on their foreheads. So we're talking about being marked, being sealed, belonging to God, and these scriptures suggest the idea that when we are marked for a salvation that will ultimately, in the end time, be seen. We also see in verse 14, and I'll read this again, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of His glory. The Spirit gives us assurance. And that's the reason I make sure I say that word, because it's in your notes. The Spirit gives us assurance of our salvation. We become God's possession. And it carries the idea of a down payment or an installment. If you're out, Robert, getting ready to buy a car, and you want that car, but you don't have all the cash, you might say, here's $500. And what is that $500 given to say? I will be back. I will be back because I want this car. And so God, in reminding us that He will come for us and take us to heaven, He has given us the Holy Spirit as that down payment, as that installment to give us assurance. Hey, He left His Holy Spirit. He's not going to just leave Him with me. He's going to come and take me to be with God in heaven. Now it is God, 2 Corinthians 5:5. Now it is God who has made us for this very purpose and has given us the Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. I cannot think, I've heard a lot of guarantees in my life. I cannot think of a better guarantee than one that comes from God. And He guarantees by the Spirit that He will return for us. When Britain and France were at war, men were conscripted into the French army. It was sort of a lottery system if your name was drawn. When someone was taken, he had to go to battle. On one occasion, the authorities came to a man and they told him, "You have been selected. You are now in the army." And the man replied this way, "I'm not going. I was shot and killed 2 years ago." Now, what would you think if you heard that? You would have thought this man was crazy, and they did. But he insisted this is indeed the case. He claimed that the military records would prove what he was saying and would show that he had been killed in action. And the people that were there with him, "How can that be? How can you be dead? You're right here." He explained that when his name first came up, a close friend came to him and said this, "You have a large family, but I have no one who is dependent upon me. I'll take your name. I'll take your address. I'll go in your place." And that's exactly what the man did. And the record showed that. And this man did die in battle. This was such an unusual case that they went to Napoleon Bonaparte himself. And he decided that the country had no legal claim on the man. He was free. He had died. And this is so important for you to note right now. He had died in the person of another. He died in another person. We all can lay claim to that very thing, a similar blessing, if we choose to accept what Christ has done for us. But we've got to have relationship with Jesus. Because you need to see that 1,000 people could die for you, but those deaths would have no meaning. But it is only Jesus who gives meaning, because one, He's the Son of God, fully divine, fully human. What was He? He was without sin. He lived a sinless life. And where we may differ from this man, He had someone to die in His place. In His place, He died. We have someone to die in our place, but does that mean that we will live ultimately? Not unless we come to relationship with Him. Our sermon is entitled, "You Don't Have to Do It Yourself." You know the truth, and it's written right there for you, you can't. You can't do it yourself. Scripture reminds us we're not good enough to earn salvation. We can't work our way into heaven. Jesus is the only way, and He said that in Scripture. "I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No man comes to the Father except or but through me." Through God's mercy, you can have life today. Have you asked Jesus to be your Savior, your Lord? Have you asked Him to forgive your sin? If not, do that this day. Let's stand and pray. Lord, we are grateful for Your word, and we thank You that by Your mercy, by Your grace, You have given us one more day to think about our future, to think where we will stand when we leave this earth. And whether we are young or old, that day comes closer. I pray today, Lord, that You would convict each of us. If we don't know Jesus as our Savior, if we don't know Jesus for salvation, that we would cry out today asking for forgiveness of sin, inviting Jesus into our hearts and lives, and giving Him thanks for the death that He endured in our place and the promise of eternal life that He offers to us. If you've never ask Jesus in your heart, if you've never received salvation, right now as you pray, say, "Jesus, I accept it. I accept it, Jesus. I need forgiveness of sin, and I thank You that You can give it and You offer it to me freely." Lord, I pray if You've led anyone here to make that decision, if you have someone watching online that needs to make that decision, they would do it this day. Those that are present with us, would you respond? Would you walk out from where you're standing, take Brother Sam's hand and say, "I've made this decision today," or come forward, pray at this altar, pray with me when I come down. It's such an important decision. As God leads you, respond this day. God may have led you here for some other reason, some decision that you're ready to share. And as God leads you, you too come. Come and speak with one of us up front. We would love to share your decision with this congregation that we may rejoice together. Lord, we pray that your Spirit would move here. May you bring conviction, and may you then give us the courage to respond. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. If you have a decision to make as we sing together, you come. Sam's already down front. I'll be there in just a moment. This altar is open for you to pray as well. You come this day.
Softly and tenderly Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals he's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home, come home, ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home. Why should we tarry when Jesus is pleading, pleading for you and for me? Why should we linger and heed not his mercies, mercies for you and for me? Come home, come home, ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home. Time is fleeting, and wonder of his promise, promise for you and for me. Though we have sinned, he has mercy and pardon, pardon for you and for me. Come home, come home, ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home.
God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen to y'all. We're going to close. Have our John, I believe you're our deacon of the week. And would you close us in prayer, and then we'll be dismissed. Brother John.
One of us.